subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
From the moment that I'm recording this, in about 36 hours, it will be all over in US presidential elections, bar the counting. Counting, I said, not the usual shouting, although shouting may come later if this election also produces an inconclusive result, as we have seen in the past, remember Al Gore and Bush. And also, America has this peculiar system whereby you can win the popular vote, as Hillary Clinton did, and yet lose the presidential election because it's state by state electoral college. So on those issues I've spoken about in the past, and I'm sharing with you an earlier Kartak letter that explained the electoral college system in quite a bit of detail. So today we will only talk quite briefly about some issues as we go into the last leg of this election campaign. As you know, in America, unlike in India, there is no such thing as last moment, 48 hours before you can say nothing, etc., etc. This morning I woke up to see a tweet from Donald Trump saying Joe Biden is a confirmed agent or something, or stooge or agent of Fidel Castro, don't vote for him. So you can say anything. There's no code of conduct that also pulls you up or disqualifies you for using unparliamentary language, etc., etc. Having said that, what does the picture look like 36 hours before the voting is completed? Now, if you look at all the pollsters say that Joe Biden is way ahead. In fact, the difference now only is Joe Biden having a narrower victory or Joe Biden having a landslide. But in that, a third possibility has emerged. And that third possibility, that obviously a lot of it is being talked about by Trump supporters, and Trump has a lot of supporters. So if I look at Real Clear Politics, which is respected and large and very detailed American political website. In fact, I want to steal some ideas from Real Clear Politics for the print.in as we go ahead. So Real Clear Politics actually tells you a remarkable finding that Trump's approval ratings today are no different from what they were 4 years back. So in the history of American politics, probably he's had the most consistent approval ratings over 4 years. So these were about 40% to begin with. These are about 40% now, which means Trump loyalists really don't leave him. In fact, if anything, at this instant, according to Real Clear Politics, his ratings are a percentage point higher than they were 4 years ago. So what this means is that his loyal base, his core remains intact. But remember, this is America. This is not India, where you can win an election with, you can sweep an election with 40% vote or 41% vote, because all the vote gets divided among many candidates. America is a two-party system. So to win, you really have to cross that 50%. And to get that additional 10% is very tough, because those are undecided voters and those are not committed to you. So that is the situation. But Trump still has his 40% support base, solid, intact, ossified, nobody can even chip at it. So given that situation, is it a possibility that given what a bad name he's got, particularly in the media, and he's seen to be this crude and rude and controversial person, a lot of his voters are probably shy of admitting that they are Trump voters, and so they are not telling it to the pollsters. Now, this is a debate that's going on, and I heard a very interesting conversation on this on 538.com. Now, 538 is basically a polling analysis, polling, political polling analysis kind of platform that Nate Silver, the famous American pollster, has set up. Remember, in 2016, all pollsters went wrong because they all thought Hillary was winning, but Trump won. So that health warning is needed all the time, and I might repeat it as we go along. But this is Nate Silver's website, and there is a podcast there that I heard, and this is a conversation between Galen Druk and Nate Silver himself. And the same question is raised: could there be a silent, shy Trump voter who will come out and vote on the 3rd of November and turn the tables? And if that happens, where will the pollsters hide now? So I'm giving you some highlights on this. So first of all, Nate Silver says that if you look at the odds now, the odds are that for presidency, Biden is winning 89%. So Biden has 89% chance of winning the presidency, and Democrats have 77% chance of winning the Senate and 98% chance of winning the House. That is the Congress. Given those odds, it's difficult to see how this could reverse. We've also seen that the Economist said just the other day that the chance of Biden winning is now more than 90%. But I'll tell you what, there is something that I know from my experience covering elections and politics in India for a long time, that when everybody seems to agree on the outcome of the election, particularly all the journalists on the spot and also pollsters, sometimes exactly the opposite happens. Because what happens is that journalists, pollsters do often, it's a bit of a stereotype, I'm not saying everybody is unprofessional, but there is a trap that they talk to each other, they consult each other, then they say, this guy can't be wrong, this guy got it right the last time, so maybe this is the truth. And a little bit of herd mentality builds up. So even if you look at all that, then 89% is quite high. But as Nate Silver points out himself, that Trump still has more than a 10% chance of winning, say 11% chance of winning. 11% is not zero. So it means that there can be some possibilities or some permutations and combinations whereby he could even win and prove everybody wrong. Now, a few factors then emerge, and Nate Silver and other experts that you read and that you hear from and the TV that you watch, all of them seem to agree that it's very difficult for Trump now to turn the tables, even in the Electoral College system. Unless he does, really, he brings about some kind of a miracle in the key battleground states, and we'll talk about them. So the few factors that Nate Silver mentions, because he thinks that Biden is winning, the few factors, one, that nothing in the news cycle has changed in the last week or 10 days to shift this momentum in favor of Trump. If anything, he says, the COVID numbers have gone up so dramatically that this is negative for Trump. Number two, the fact is that by this Friday, and America has a very peculiar system of campaigning, voting, everything. They do it all differently because they're American. That's why I said you can get more votes than the other guy and still lose the election because it's America. So in America, they open the ballots much earlier, so you can vote over a long period, and you can vote by mail or you can drop your vote off. So 60% of the voters, in terms of numbers, of the total number of voters who voted in 2016, 60% had already voted in America by last Friday. And remember, we are recording this on Monday evening, so by Friday, by previous Friday, 60%, more than 60% had already voted. That is 85 million people, or 8.5 crore people had voted till last Friday, and this is going on. So how many will come out to vote on the polling day? And if you see the trend so far, it doesn't look like the trend is any different from what the polls are suggesting. Although Nate Silver and Galen Druk say again and again that in the past records tell you that a count of those who voted earlier does not give you a true indication or a conclusive indication of where the election is going to go on the final day. It is possible, for example, in this case, that more of the Democratic voters have come out to vote than Republican voters. And some of this is shown in data that these pollsters put out. For example, of those who voted estimate, because every state in America does not register voters in terms of their parties. So the estimates are that all those who have voted already by last Friday, 47% are registered Democrats, 30% are registered Republicans, and most importantly, 23% are unaffiliated voters. Now, once again, there are qualifications there. So I could be registered with Democratic Party and voting Republican, or I could be a BJP member and voting Congress, or Congress member and voting BJP. Who knows what happens inside a polling booth? But also, it's not just changing of mind, but somebody may have registered as a with one party 30 years ago and continues like that, and meanwhile might have changed her mind. So those things are still uncertainties. But the fact is that with so many people having voted already, what a dramatic shift could take place on the polling day is now much less. So this is now a record-breaking advance voting in America's electoral history. Now the third point is, which gives Trump supporters a little bit of heart, is that one, there are not enough high-quality polls in Pennsylvania, which is a battleground state, and Nate Silver also says that. And second, it does look like the race in Florida, North Carolina, besides Pennsylvania, has tightened a bit. But again, as Nate Silver says, tightening doesn't mean narrowing. If you were 8% ahead, you are 7% ahead now. It's tightening, but it's not really narrowing. Narrowing is if from 6% ahead, you came to 4% ahead. But there is a little bit of tightening. Is there enough time now for the momentum to shift? The pollsters don't think so, but it's always a theoretical possibility. At the same time, these pollsters tell you that in Georgia and Ohio, two other battleground states, Biden's actually doing better than before, which means there also the race has tightened, but tightened in Biden's favor, just as in the other three, the race has tightened a little bit away from Biden towards Trump in favor. Favor doesn't mean that the other person is winning necessarily. So Trump is not winning at this point, Florida, North Carolina, Pennsylvania, but the gap has narrowed just a little bit. And then you have Michigan and Wisconsin, where it looks like at this point that Biden is way ahead. These are all battleground states. Biden is ahead by 16 percentage points and 10 percentage points. It's a lot. And then again in Wisconsin, if Trump might have seen any chance of turning the tide now, it looks much tougher because Wisconsin particularly has seen a very steep rise in coronavirus numbers and people are really suffering there. Just to give you a brief idea of what the battleground states are, we know that America has 538 electoral college votes. That's why this website is also called 538. You have to get more than half of that to become president of America. So you need 275. And you see this map, the electoral college map of America on our screen. You can see state like California with 55 electoral college votes, and others with 5, 6, 3, 20, 16, you need 270. So 272 in America is like the 272 of India, because India has a house of 543. You need 242 to rule India. Similarly, America has an electoral college of 538, 270 to become president of America. Now to get those 270, because you know that some states are pre-decided, you know that Democrats will win California, for example. You know Democrats will win New York. You know they will win some of the other eastern states. But similarly, you also know that Republicans will win many other states called red states. So America is quite polarized between red and blue. Now, battleground states are those where change can take place. And at this point, here are the states that we count in that category. That is Pennsylvania, North Carolina, Georgia, Florida, Arizona, and they have 20 plus 15 plus 16 plus 29 for Florida. That's why Florida is so important. If Trump loses Florida, he cannot win the election. So Pennsylvania 20, North Carolina 15, Georgia 16, Florida 29, Arizona 11. Together, there are 91 electoral college votes. And if you also throw in Wisconsin to it, then Biden is ahead there also. So in all these, Biden is ahead. For Trump to win now, he will have to reverse the tide in all of these states. Is that possible? Or most of these states, particularly Florida. If that's possible, Florida is also, by the way, the closest. If that's possible, if he can do that, that will be miraculous. But that is one way he can win. Also, if you look at Real Clear Politics, right now they are giving the odds at 49.1% Biden and if 45.8% Trump. So once again, on every parameter, Biden is up. Now the question of shy Trump voters, to which this analysis says, the argument is There can be a shy Trump voter, but usually you find that voters of the right or conservative voters are less shy to say who they will vote for. They are more upfront. And second, while they can be shy Trump voters, where is the guarantee? It's an argument. Where is the guarantee or where is the reasoning that suggests that shy Trump voters could be more than shy Biden voters? It could also be that a lot of conservative voters or Republican Party voters may this time be wanting to vote against Trump because they don't like how Trump has run the government. And I will give you a quote from the Wall Street Journal on that in just a couple of minutes. So there is no argument or there is no reasoning that suggests that while there may be shy Trump voters, that there won't be shy Biden voters or that shy Trump voters would be more than shy Biden voters. Also, these pollsters tell you that as of now, Democratic supporters and voters seem more enthusiastic than Trump voters. And they say that that America's history tells you electoral history. In India, we say that we've never found any, our pollsters say they found no link between turnout and who's going to win. But in America, they say higher turnout favors the Democrats. It does look like this time America is heading for a high turnout. So I will conclude today with a quote from the Wall Street Journal. Wall Street Journal, we know, is a paper of the right. Its editorial pages are Trump supporters. They are Republican supporters, as much as New York Times might be a Biden supporter or a Democratic supporter. Now, there is this very interesting editorial in the Wall Street Journal that I am sharing with you. Now, this is like a two Wall Street Journal. They are still wishing that Trump wins. And they are saying that Trump will be a better choice. But they also show a lot of anger and disappointment with Trump. For example, they talk about Trump's Panglossian claims. That almost looks like a word that Shashi Tharoor invented. Panglossian claims of rounding the turn, that he always says, I've turned the corner on coronavirus, on China, on this, on that. But at the same time, they say, they give their reasoning for why they think Democratic Party should be defeated and Trump should win. And they say that it is important to put brakes on Democratic Party because this party is increasingly radical on the economy and culture. And then it goes on to say, and Mr. Biden would not be able or even willing to put that brake on the Democratic Party, which is now going to the very radical left on the economy and on culture. And they say that only Trump can do it. Then they say that maybe there would have been a protection if even if Biden had won, at least the Senate had stayed with the GOP, with the Republican Party. But they said it now looks like if Trump goes down, he might take the Senate down with him also. He might take the Republicans down in the Senate as well. So they are concerned about a situation where you might have a Biden presidency and Biden unable to stop the radicals or control the radicals in his party and the party controlling the Senate also. That they don't want. But they say something in conclusion, which I'll read in full. They say Joe Biden and the Democrats could not make Mr. Trump the third incumbent in a century to be fired after a single term. In America, in 100 years, only two presidents have lost after their first term. The last one was Jimmy Carter. Joe Biden and the Democrats couldn't make Mr. Trump the third incumbent in a century to be fired after a single term. Only Donald Trump could do it. So what happens on November 3 will be a test of whether Donald Trump can defeat himself or not.